We are. Take that with you with Falwell Damaris. That's Falwell. I'm Damaris. You know that because that is the voice of the Mavericks TV play-by-play. FC Dallas now in season.
Yep.
The Olympics, World Cup, you name it. This man does it. There is no off position on Mark Falwell.
And what you said that in your D Magazine article. There's no off position for the genius switch, right?
That's true. That is true because I, as editor Mike Pellucci credited me, I was pro J Kidd when he got hired. I was pro trade, and right. I picked the Mavs in 7. And he said he's got to start listening to me. Of course, I picked the Mavs in 6,
which can still happen.
And they dropped game 1, 112-87. I've got to credit you, Mark Falwell, because you had it that Steve Kerr now is 21-2 in game 1s in his career. He knows how to take his team and come out strong and deliver the first punch.
Okay, so that seems like this is going to be a Golden State point. I have other things written down, but since you started out with that, you brought that up, let me ask you this. Is that good coaching by Steve Kerr? Is that just the Occam's razor of, hey, most of these series they play, they're the more talented team. They're playing at home, obviously, and they're winning because of that. Is it that they have the right mentality? They know how to hit the ground running in a series and start the right way and hit first, you know, a phrase that we like to use very often. What do you think is behind that?
I think a few things. One is, I think Kerr does benefit from having a very talented team.
Yeah. I mean, ultimately, that's the most important thing in all of this stuff is being talented.
The proof of that is obviously when he was out, Luke Walton was 37-4 coaching the Warriors.
Good point.
And
fair point.
Luke Walton has washed through two teams since.
Right.
So there's no doubt Kerr's an excellent coach. He also benefits greatly from a very, very talented roster. Number two is they have now, later, obviously you can't do that in the first times they've been doing this, but experience. They've been here before.
Right.
And this is a larger stage. I think you pointed out, Finney Smith said he's never seen this many cameras before the other day.
Yeah, he did say that after their Tuesday practice.
So there is an off-court adjustment and a pressure and ratcheting up. We saw that. You know, I think teams that are first in the playoffs get that after the regular season into the first round.
Right.
The Mavs got smacked in the face in game 1, second round to first round. There's another stair step up that they weren't prepared for. And this is yet another level in intensity and level of play because of the caliber of team you're playing, because you're playing one of the four best teams left.
Right. Now, granted, they did not get off, and I did say this last time when we talked on the ticket. I said I didn't think they would get off to as bad of a start as they did against Phoenix. I thought they'd get off to a good start. They did lead twice in the first quarter last night.
But then it got away from them.
Yeah, it got away from them by the late second quarter. There was a point in time.
Well, it was even in the first, they were down 10.
Yeah, there was a point in time I was watching, and at 38-35, with four-ish minutes left in the second quarter, I was like, wow.
How are they back in
this? They're only down by 3.
And I even tweeted something that the, you know, good news is at halftime, you're in a game where you shot so poorly from 3, you're only down 9.
Yeah.
Bad news is Steph and Clay haven't gone off yet.
Right.
And so, but to last answer to your question, I think the Warriors and the way they play is the last element that puts that over the top. I think that the Mavs have seen two pick and roll teams that have static basketball and have dominant players who they can try to key on, Donovan Mitchell, Devin Booker. This is the ball movement and the body movement of Golden State is a shock to the system. Even if you played them 4 times in the regular season.
I concur.
You haven't played them fully healthy. Draymond Green was not in those last couple games post-trade. Clay was not the Clay that he is now. I think that when you add all that together, Kerr, the talent, been there before, the leveling up, and also the style of play. I think most importantly, that is something that just takes some time for not just the Mavs, but every team, because they're 21-2 in game 1s, to adjust to.
It's an interesting point. Yeah, I would haven't thought about it from that perspective, but I would concur. When you bring that up, that's a very logical, sound point that you bring up. This is looking ahead rather than looking back at last night's game, Brian. But since you brought the point up about them being 21-2 in game 1s, let me just say this right here. And this is Golden State in their runs under Steve Kerr. This is their 23rd playoff series under Steve Kerr, obviously by the 21-2 game one record. They've won 20 of the first 22 playoff series, only losing in the finals twice. They've won now, after last night, 86 of 117 playoff games, over 73%. They are 52-11 at home in the playoffs. They're 34-20 on the road in the playoffs. As we'll get to whenever they come to Dallas, we'll elaborate a little bit more on this. They've won a road game in all 22 playoff series that they played in under Steve Kerr. Now, this is the thing that I think that is really important about tomorrow night's game. And we'll get to the recap, of course, of last night here in a moment, but since you brought it up. They've taken a 2-0 lead, Brian, in 15 of the 22 playoff series that they played under Steve Kerr and are going to try to make it 16 of 23 tomorrow night. They've won 14 of those 15 playoff series when they've taken a 2-0 lead.
They're 19-1 when taking a one-game lead.
Yeah, there you go. So, you know, they've only...
The only loss being, of course, Cleveland. When they were down, they were up 3-1 and Draymond got kicked out.
I mean, look, they've lost two playoff series under Steve Kerr against Cleveland in 2016 in the finals, that one. And then the 2019 finals against Toronto.
When Durant and Clay went down with season-ending injuries.
Absolutely. So besides those two series, and this is where I'm going with this, is that they don't ever have to play from behind and chase series. And, you know, a lot of that's on them because they're good, but they don't get off to bad starts. They don't face a lot of adversity, comparatively speaking, to a lot of other teams in these series. 2015 and round two, they went down 2-1 to Memphis. They won in six.
And that was early in that tenure.
Yes.
That was before the 73 win season. That was the old Barnes Iguodala version of the death lineup.
Correct.
And there was a lot of hand-wringing around, is this team really all that? They're down 2-1 to this grit-and-grind defensive team, and then they just took over.
They were down 2-1 to Cleveland in the finals in 2015. They won in six. That was when Steve Kerr made his Rick Carlisle, J.J. Barea-type adjustment. They put Iguodala into the starting lineup for games 4, 5, and 6, and they won all three of those games.
And, of course, that was the series that Iguodala actually won finals MVP for his defense on LeBron, and that was taking Looney out and playing death from the start.
2016 Western Conference Finals. Was it Bogut then who I think maybe they took out of the starting lineup?
It was Bogut.
I think
good call.
Looney got drafted like a year later. But he's, we're going to get to him from last night.
Or Bogu, as some people call him.
You may have a story to tell me that I'm not aware of. 2016 Western Conference Finals, down 3-1 to OKC. They won in seven. 2018,
that was, of course, Game 6 Clay.
Yeah.
That was the last version of the Oklahoma City Thunder as we saw them because, of course, Durant went to the Warriors right after that series.
And 2018 Western Conference Finals, down 3-2 to Houston, 1-7.
Chris Paul gets hurt. And the rest is history.
That's 27 straight threes Houston did in
game seven.
The point of all of that is this, that they don't face the prospect of being back on their heels and chasing series very often. And here they are again with a 1-0 lead and the possibility of taking a 2-0 lead tomorrow. And that's not to, I'm not, the point of that is not to somehow diminish their extraordinary run. I'm trying to really point out how special their run has been. And they don't face adversity very often, and that's what obviously we're hoping that from the Maverick perspective of things, of course, that's what we're hoping that they can do is, when it starts tomorrow night, is start putting pressure on them. Somehow, if you can get a lead in this series, we saw what it did to Phoenix, although the Mavericks didn't lead in the series, but the Mavericks pushed Phoenix where their backs were against the wall in an elimination game, and Phoenix crumbled. They melted down. Golden State, I think, has got more to them mentally than Phoenix does because of their experience. But can the Mavericks get Golden State at some point in time in this series back on their heels? Obviously, last night, they did not.
Draymond Green said on TNT last night after the 50-point loss or whatever it ended up being to Memphis in Game 5 that he wasn't worried. Again, hindsight, he can say that now, but still, that they had confidence they could come back home and close the series. And I don't doubt that they did because
I don't either.
They've made these comebacks, and they played from ahead and gone, okay, we know what we need to do. Now, sometimes it bites them in the butt because they play with their food a little bit and think, oh, we'll just turn it on when we need to. But they do have that confidence. But you're right. I think, you said this last series, chasing the game and chasing the series.
Right.
And when did, as you said, the Phoenix Suns series switch? when we were no longer chasing it.
Right.
And the pressure was on them in game seven. We were all even back finally, mm-hmm. and we could take over.
Yep.
What did the Mavs do in game one? Well, from the jump, when we were down 10 in the first quarter, we're chasing the game,
mm-hmm.
and we're chasing the series now.
Mm-hmm.
And we're doing that over and over again. And so I hear, oh, well, we did that the first two rounds of the series. Yeah, that can come bite you in the butt, though.
Yeah.
Especially against a much more talented team like Golden State, who has the experience that you just laid out. So you can't just say, you know, we have talked about all year, oh, all these double-digit comebacks. Well, that means you're down double digits.
Yeah, and it's a great thing to be able to do that. That's awesome.
But
yeah,
you're also been down.
You know, I had a FC Dallas game, as you pointed out, last night, and I didn't get to hear what you guys talked about in the post-game show. We chatted on the pregame show on the ticket, and I heard a lot of the host. You know, Brian and I both do stuff there. Have for a long time, you know, so a lot of times we get here on the podcast and we reference things on the ticket. I know we have a lot of viewers who are not in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. That's a very popular sports radio station here. I mean, you know, hands down, the best in the best in town, best in the country, you know, quite arguably. So we make appearances on there frequently. You were on there yesterday. I was on there, I think, Tuesday.
Yeah,
or
we're doing
like
pregame
that.
Shows before every game, yeah. So I don't know.
I admire the guys that we work with that they have said, they said last night, I'm not going to freak out if they lose game one. We've learned our lesson. And this is true. Game one does not a series make. The Mavericks have bounced back from losing game one to Utah and bounced back from losing the two games against Phoenix. And I really do like the fact that they've come around on that thought process. However, I would like to say, there is a reason that every broadcast that does games in the playoffs points out the game one winner goes on to win 76 or 77% of the time, whatever it is, that when you go up 2-0, you win series and best of sevens 92% of the time or whatever the number is, somewhere in the low 90s percentage-wise. It is hard to keep doing what the Mavericks are trying to do. As a matter of fact, there's only one team, Brian, in a playoff run that has lost game one in three different series and come back to win those three series.
I have no idea who that team is.
Last year's Milwaukee Bucks.
There you go.
They swept Miami in the first round, so that's obviously not one of them. But remember, they went down 1-0 and actually 2-0 to Brooklyn. They did the same thing the Mavericks did against Phoenix last year against Brooklyn.
Game 7.
Yeah, where it was the home team won the first six games of the series, and then Milwaukee won on the road in Game 7. Remember last year, Atlanta shocked the world after beating Philly in Game 7. Atlanta took a 1-0 lead over Milwaukee. Milwaukee ultimately won the series in 6. And then, remember, of course, Phoenix went up 2-0 last year in the finals, and Milwaukee won 4 straight games to win that series in 6. So it did happen very recently, if we want to draw on recent history. But that's, again, the only team to lose game one in 3 series in a playoff run. And I'm just looking at this, by the way, since 1984, when everybody had to start playing 4 rounds in the playoffs. So since then, Milwaukee is the only team, Brian, to lose game one in 3 series and win them in an individual playoff run. So, you know, what the Mavericks are now trying to do is something that there just isn't a whole lot of precedent for. Not to say that they can't do it. They've adjusted well in all of these previous series, and obviously they've got a lot of work they've got to do today on the off day between games one and two to adjust and prepare for tomorrow night.
And it's a matter of setting the tone, and we've talked about when the Mavs set the tone and they play their style with aggressiveness, with physical play defensively, with attacking the paint offensively, that they don't believe they can. They believe they will win. Mm-hmm. They have that belief.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that about them. But Golden State came in with a plan, and they set the tone. And Draymond Green gave us the plan post-game. You know, he yaps a lot, and he basically told us. Steph Curry said after the game, there were two things in our game plan, and we executed them both. Well, Draymond told us what they were. They wanted to move the ball. They wanted to not have it stick so much. And they didn't want to get bogged down like Phoenix did in targeting one player, a la Luka.
Mm-hmm.
Body movement, ball movement. They
right.
succeeded in that.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing they wanted to do was defend without fouling. And they were able to do that as well.
Yeah.
Those were their two key big picture things that they were able to set the tone with.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you switch to what happened in this game, when you really look at the first few minutes of the game, the Mavs were actually getting the shots they wanted. They just weren't falling.
Correct. I agree with that.
And that led to some frustration, I think. But you can't really falter the game plan initially. This is a three-point shooting team. Now, I think they got three-point happy. In this game, they shot 56% of their shots were threes, 48 out of 86.
Yeah, 48 threes.
And oh, by the way, before garbage time, I looked at this stat early fourth quarter. It was 2/3 of their shots were from three.
Wow.
It was about 42. It was exactly 42 out of 69 shots.
Wow.
Were from three, which is literally 2/3.
Wow.
Just about. So that's way too many. And what you have to do, and what they were doing, and we showed a package of this in postgame on Bally Sports, is that they weren't touching the paint before the threes. They got out of that.
I would agree with that.
What happened in the, you know, I think the first half you can say, okay, basically what happened in the first half was the others carried Golden State through that half. Combined, Steph Curry and Klay had 12 points, but Steph's were really late in the second quarter, actually. Mm-hmm. Early on, through the first quarter, they were both scoreless.
Yeah.
And the Loonies of the world, the Wigginses of the world, the Pools of the world
off the bench,
carried them through that, which, frankly, if you're going to gamble and play defense by the Mavs, that's what you want to do, force those to hit shots. Mm-hmm. And they were forcing them to hit tough mid-range shots. Mm-hmm. We saw this early in the Phoenix series where they had come in shooting over 50% eight straight games. They were, you know, they hit those tough mid-range shots for the first two games, and we said, okay, can they keep this up? Well, they didn't. Well, Golden State came in. They hit mid-range shots that we wanted them to take. Mm-hmm. We ran them up. They only hit 20. They only attempted 29 threes. They attempt, what, 40 a game usually?
Yeah, so close to that, 37, 38.
So that strategy was right. Again, trade threes for twos. Well, our threes weren't falling, and they were hitting their mid-range shots.
It's funny you bring that up because Stan Van Gundy said on the broadcast in the second quarter, Golden State is building their lead by making twos. And of course, you know, and especially in recent years, man, I've really come around on the whole idea of, you know, there was a point in time I was a little reluctant to fully embrace the whole threes are better than twos kind of thing. But, you know, obviously that is the case. But I've said for a long time, and it still is applicable, that yes, threes are better than twos, but twos are better than zeros.
Right. And you just mentioned the 27 straight threes missed by the Rockets in that game seven.
Yeah.
You have to have a plan B. And the Mavs kept shooting. Now, there's two schools of thought. One is you just keep shooting it until you get there.
Right.
I think you and I think, go get some buckets just to change it up a little bit and see the ball go through the hoop. Have a plan inside. And when you're shooting 2/3 of your shots from three and you're not even attacking the paint anymore because you're pressing because they're scoring on the other side, and you're pressing a little bit psychologically on your end, then you're just, and we showed these highlights, you're just passing around the three-point line and taking a contested look. Mm-hmm. These weren't, the looks in the third quarter weren't the same as the looks in the first half that weren't falling. So what do the Warriors do to that point when you're taking away their three? Well, they can hit the mid-range. Mm-hmm. Now, will they always hit at that level? We'll see. I don't think so.
Phoenix didn't. They did it as the first, but they didn't as the thing went
along. And will
those
other players, like, you know, will Wiggins have a great game, seven games? No, he won't, right? I mean, I'm a Wiggins hater, but still, I still don't think he's going to play to that level all the time.
Right.
And, we're going to have to see it from Poole. We're going to have to see it from Looney. So the game plan was right, but when you don't hit your shots on your offensive end, it looks really bad.
Yeah, that's true. You know, a long, long time ago, John Wooden said the most important statistic in a game of basketball is field goal percentage. He was not into whatever analytics there were when he was leading UCLA to a bunch of titles in the 60s and 70s. He was not embracing those. It was all about field goal percentage. Last night, and to your point a little bit ago, garbage time made it even look better than this not very good number. 56% is what Golden State shot. 36% is what the Mavs shot last night.
But they only shot 34.5% from three.
Golden State, that is.
That's right.
Yes, but so which, to your point, means that they were outstanding on their twos. I mean, 36, that would make them 36 of 53 on two-pointers.
Yes.
And that's a darn good percentage. That's probably up into the 60s. That's probably very close
70%.
To 70%. Yeah.
If you double 36, that's 72.
Yeah,
so
there you go. So
that's the kind of math you get here on Take That With You.
How about that? You know, they were, to your point, so listen to this on the kind of threes that they were generating last night. They had 28 three-point shots were the closest, according to NBA.com when I looked this morning.
Yes, they had open looks.
Yeah, 28 three-point shots were the closest defender was 6 feet or farther away from the three-point shooter, but only went 8 for 28 on those shots. They had 16 more three-point shots where the closest defender was 4 to 6 feet away. That's not a wide open shot, but it's also not like a somebody right up in your body contested shot either. And they went 3 for 16 on those threes. Is it just simply a case of not making shots last night? I don't know that, you know, we can boil it down to that and that alone, because I do think there are some things to talk about on the defensive end for the Mavericks that have to get better. But to your point a minute ago, their three-point shots that they generated last night, there were some, actually more than some, quite a few that were good looks and that they didn't make, and that they didn't even make anywhere remotely close to the rate at which they had been making them in the playoffs before this.
So the question is this a combination of nerves, level of play, competition, playing on the road, attacking the paint enough? Is it a soup of all that that kind of combines to that?
That's what I think. Yes. Yeah. Yes. I don't know that there's any one thing that I would point to. I'm more in, if that's what you're saying, you think, or yes. You're just asking. Yeah, I think it's the soup. Yes, I think it's a soup. The answer is soup.
They were 11 of 48, 23%. They were 36% overall. You're just not going to win or even be competitive in those games.
By the way, the answer, though, is not cereal is soup, because some people will ask that like really weird question. Did you know that?
That's not even,
That's
not even a topic
of
discussion.
Is cereal soup? And it's not. So just want to make sure.
I won't even acknowledge that as a question.
People ask that on Twitter, man. I'm serious.
Is that in the oeuvre of hot dog as a sandwich kind of question?
Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah, which is, a hot dog is not a sandwich, by the way. So,
well, these are topics for the summer when we're desperate for content. You want to look at the nerdy stats: rebounds, turnovers, and threes. That's what I always look at.
Okay.
Minus 16 on the rebounding battle, which is frankly surprising considering that we're both smalls.
Mm-hmm. I do want to revisit that in a second, but go ahead.
Steph Curry was their leading rebounder with 12. Why was he their leading rebounder? Because when you miss threes, they're long rebounds. Yep. And what happens on long rebounds? You run it down the court in transition. I think that's what happened, especially in the third quarter, which gave the Mavs a very similar feel to, I believe it was game 5, third quarter of the Phoenix Suns series.
Correct.
That things get out of hand. Mm-hmm. When the rebounds start hitting the transition opportunities the other way, they're getting easy buckets. Your defense starts breaking down. You get slump shoulder. You press on the offensive end, and it just starts feeding on itself, and you get turnovers. Luka in this game had 7 turnovers. He had 6 shot attempts. Mm-hmm. That's never happened before in his playoff career. Minus 16, their second leading rebounder was Draymond Green. Looney only had 5 after having 22 in game 6 of their series with Memphis.
Did have a couple of key offensive rebounds in the first half, though.
Yes.
Yep.
Turnovers, we were a plus 2. We did have 13 more than usual. Golden State did cough it up like we expected them to with 15. And threes, we were only a plus 1 on threes, plus 3 points, plus 1 with 11 maids, and they had 10 makes. So that recipe being down 16 rebounds, but only compensating it with 2 less turnovers and 3 more points on the three-point line, ain't math that gives you a win.
No. I thought one thing that was something that happened early in the game that gave me, concern. Two things. Number one, man, Bobby did a great film room about Golden State and their ball movement and body movement and how they've set 400 more off-ball screens than any team in the league. And Bobby, on the film room, you showed about Steph getting so much attention, and then that gives other players an opportunity to move well without the ball. And I want to say that maybe the second or third made basket last night for Golden State was Looney going to the basket. Everybody focused on Steph and Looney wide open going to the basket and then finding him with the pass. And another thing that Looney did early on is, man, you cannot, whenever the rarest of rare things, like a Halley's Comet sort of thing occurs, and Steph goes 0 for 2 at the line, you cannot not get the free throw rebound.
Yeah.
And I think Looney kept that alive, and they ended up getting a putback whenever Steph had just gone 0 for 2 from the line. And, there were other moments last night, Brian, where not finding shooters in transition, not stopping the ball in transition. I mean, there are things that Dallas is can improve on other than just the make-or-miss league shot making. And I thought transition defense, an area of significant improvement for the Mavericks all season long, I thought there was, there was one fast break basket last night where nobody stopped the ball and Steph goes all the way to the basket. There were other transition opportunities where they didn't find shooters in transition and guys got open looks. And to Golden State's credit, by the way, they have guys who get the three-point shot off very quickly. So, you know, that makes finding them quickly in transition even more important because they don't need much time and space to get three-pointers off. And I thought that was something that was... it's not a hard adjustment. You know, this is not some sort of like massive, like strategical thing that you've got to figure out. You know, this is the rebounding thing that you brought up. I mean, a lot of these are just attention to detail, focus, energy, effort sort of things.
And when you're a step slow because you're chasing people around, then you're reaching with your hands, you're committing fouls, you're also not boxing out, and those attention to detail little things slip from you.
And there was not a lot of foul trouble last night, but Kleba getting in foul trouble in the first half certainly was not helpful.
3 fouls in 8 minutes in the first half.
Yep.
Everybody's carping about why is Powell starting. That's why Powell's starting.
Yes.
Powell's eating up some minutes. He's an innings-eating pitcher.
Yeah.
Who's eating up minutes because you just can't afford to get Maxey in foul. I mean, like I said, 3 fouls in 8 minutes in the first half. That's, mm-hmm. He played 8 minutes. He only played 19 minutes in this game and scored 3 points. So, and when he gets into foul trouble, it gets into his head. He's less aggressive defensively, and he's mm-hmm. probably hesitant with his shot as well. And he goes 1 for 4 from three. So, the Maxey foul trouble is something that you have to keep an eye on because he's so important defensively for you because then you're forced to play Bertans minutes in the second quarter and then when you have to go micro ball. So that's something to keep an eye on.
Any thought on the, I said I wanted to ask you about this. What was your perspective on the 51-35 rebounding deficit for the Mavs? Was that just an energy effort? I mean, you and I are both surprised by this.
Yeah.
You know, that we thought the Mavericks would be able to hold their own rebounding in this series. And ultimately, they may be able to do so. They did not last night, however.
Yeah, I think that the, like I was saying, I think that the, because they were in their heads defensively and a step slow, that was getting them then a step slow to boxing out and getting rebounds.
Gotcha. Okay.
And then the long rebounds were you know, if sure. Curry's their leading rebounder at 12.
Then, yeah, long shot, long rebound.
Then, then that's the key. But that leads to the fast break points. The Warriors, as you mentioned, in transition, Curry said before the game he wanted to get out and run. Mm-hmm. And they did, 18 fast break points. And so that's going to be, when they're doing that, and they're getting that crowd hyped up and they're getting on a roll and they're believing in themselves, that's what it starts rolling downhill, and that's what you saw in the third quarter. Mm-hmm. They did have a balanced attack where they had, before garbage time, they'd only played 8 players. Mm-hmm. Otto Porter, Poole came off the bench, and a little bit of Lee.
Yeah, Damian Lee.
Very few minutes of Lee. Mm-hmm. And outside of Lee, all 7 players who played were in double figures.
Right. Yep.
So they had a balanced attack. But again, if we're looking silver lining on this, I think the strategy was right, which is we're going to make the others beat you. Mm-hmm. They just did in this game. But are they going to be able to do that 4 times if that's really your strategy? Because Curry said after the game, you know, they did run us off the 3-point line. And so we went to our spots in the mid-range, and they're a team that embraces the mid-range like Phoenix does.
Right.
But can you keep hitting those? And they admitted they took the paint away from them as well, or the rim, rather, away from them as well. So, I say that to say, let's not ride the roller coaster. Let's keep a level head, like you were talking about.
When you lose, you never think you're going to win again. Right. When you win, you never think you're going to lose again.
And we're in that off-day doldrums.
Right.
And so, tighten up defensively. I think if you look at 3 things the Mavs have to do, they have to hit threes. That's the obvious. But how do you hit threes? With dribble penetration, getting you open looks. Mm-hmm. Now, they missed some open looks early. They stopped getting open looks later mm-hmm. because they stopped dribble penetrating.
Right.
They need to attack that defense. There's no rim protection when Looney's not in there, so there should be a way to get to the rim mm-hmm. and blow by these guys. Mm-hmm. And I think, and Van Gundy talked about this on the broadcast, attack smaller players. Get Curry in the action more. Mm-hmm. You know, don't just pick Looney as the big because you want to run 1-5 pick and roll or go 1-on-1 with Wiggins. Wiggins played pretty well defensively.
Yes, he did.
And they're helping well. And Draymond is huge for them defensively in terms of helping and recovering. We saw that in the block shot in the corner on Finney Smith.
Finney Smith's 3-pointer, yes.
Yeah. He can do that. He's He is so important for them, and that's why you throw these regular season games out the window, because Draymond didn't play in those last two games.
Correct.
Because of his ability offensively to be a point forward. So when you're trapping Curry, he gets that ball and distributes, mm-hmm. or when they're running pick and roll. And on defense, because of his ability to quarterback that whole operation. So they were help in recovering. They were pre-switching. So he was calling up Finney Smith, who was in the corner, and Curry was guarding him in the corner, and they would just pre-switch, and Draymond would go up there. Mm-hmm. So they were throwing multiple looks at Luka. Yep. Box and one, zone. Mm-hmm. One, two zones. Different players at him.
Yep.
I think
sometimes double, sometimes switch. Right. Yeah.
And Luka said, ironically, he said, "I hadn't seen that kind of different look since the Charlotte regular season game." Mm-hmm. And we looked it up, and that was a game that the Mavs lost by 21 points. But Luka scored 37 in that game. But guess what? Who's the second leading scorer in that game? Frank Ntilikina with 12.
Wow.
That's not a recipe for Mavs success when Luka's the only one getting his.
That would be the March 19th Charlotte game. Okay. Wow.
How do you know that's on March 19th?
It's a curse and a blessing, man.
Goodness gracious.
That is interesting to hear Luka say that. I did not know that he said that. And you know, as I was watching that game and just kind of thinking about what we were just talking about, sometimes Wiggins played him straight up. Sometimes a second defender came over. Sometimes it was a switch and a pick and roll. Sometimes it was a zone. I heard Stan Van Gundy call out a box and one, or Reggie, one of the guys, the analysts on the broadcast, called out a box and one at one point in time in the first half.
You can't give him the same steady diet. He'll figure that out.
I mean, for 23 years of doing these games, Brian, I've heard more than one coach over the years always say, when you're defending, and you know, we ask them these questions in pregame interviews and things like that, and about, well, you know, how do you stop so and so? Well, you don't stop great players. You hope to slow them down, and the way you slow them down is by throwing different looks at them so they don't get comfortable and so they don't lock in on one thing and then figure out how to beat it. And I'll be damned if that's not exactly what Golden State and Steve Kerr did last night to Luka. I mean, just a steady diet of many, many different. I mean, we just named out five different things it felt like that they did in terms of defensive coverages, team defense, or individual defenders in terms of how they dealt with him last night.
And they had Draymond on Brunson, which was, and Brunson had 14 points, but again, one of those game one inefficient Brunson games. And Brunson post game said, "I got to go be better." And what has he done every time? He's gotten better.
Yep. Correct.
And I believe that he will be.
Correct.
But yep. Draymond has been the, I think, two-time defensive player of the year.
Yeah, two or three, yeah, whatever.
For a reason.
Yeah, for sure.
As boisterous as he is, I've kind of 180'd on him a little bit. I used to really hate him, but I think he's good on TNT, and he's really smart. He's just so over the top. The two calls where he just went ballistic, he was wrong on both.
Right.
And that's kind of the hate there, right? It's like, what are you, you know, you're doing this, and Kerr's just like, no, you found him. Like, that has to be draining at some level,
right?
Being a teammate of his. Like, you want that sometimes, but then sometimes you're like, Draymond, just, we got it. But
he is very, very important to them, defensive strategy-wise, offensive ball movement, you know, point forward-wise,
and,
spiritually, emotionally-wise.
Yes.
Very important to them.
And that's why when the Warriors were in their slump was coinciding when Draymond wasn't there.
Yep, that's true.
And so, you know, him on Brunson is really smart, because if you can neutralize Brunson, then you're making Luka go one-on-one, because you don't have another playmaker and that teammate, you know, that playmate there to work with. So to go back to, you know, there's no margin for error for the Mavs, right? They got to hit threes. They do that by having dribble penetration. And then they've got to defend better. And you wanted to talk about a little bit about how the Mavs defense has got to tighten up.
Well, I think, to me, a lot of it, Brian, is transition. I mean, I really, really think that's where it is. Not stopping the ball, not finding shooters. I don't know.
We forget about transition defense a lot, because we talk about, you know, the set plays on either end of the court, but I think transition, oftentimes we go, oh, that's just, you know, boy, they beat us in fast break points.
Yeah.
But there is a strategy to, you know, you got to find your man. You got to get on him. You got to remember the ball. You got to get in the lane.
I mean, one of the things that I've pointed out about this season and the defensive improvement for Dallas, and I asked Jay Kidd about this during the regular season, and I mean, he said that, look, that's the base of your defense, is the thing that you've got to focus on first and foremost is making sure that teams don't get easy baskets in fast break or early offense situations. This has been a very, very historically, recently poor transition defense team. bottom five in the league in six of the previous eight seasons before this year. The Mavericks worked their way up to being, I think they were 12th or 13th in the league in fast break points allowed this year. And they spent a little bit of time late in the season in the top 10, as a matter of fact, Brian. So I think, you know, to me, that's the first thing that I see from a defensive standpoint. Your point a minute ago that they ran him off the three-point line, they forced him into taking twos, they did everything reasonably and realistically possible to limit opportunities for Curry and Thompson. I know they ended up both having decent shooting games. Klay was 7 for 13, but only 1 of 4 on threes. Steph was 7 for 16. Now that means he was much better on twos, 3 for 9 on threes in the game. You know, so I think there's a lot of things that they did well defensively last night. I feel like the main thing defensively that they've got to do is, one, get better in transition. And then, of course, the defensive rebound is the exclamation point in your defensive possession. And, you know, they weren't very good rebounding the basketball last night at all. You know, they weren't horrible on the defensive glass by any stretch. But, you know, Golden State had 7 offensive rebounds, but they only missed 36 shots for the whole game. You know, and there was one offensive rebound I said earlier on one of the things that I find about as maddening as there is out there, and that is free throw blockouts. And when you give up an offensive rebound on a missed free throw, especially when the missed free throws are Steph freaking Curry, a 92% career three-point free throw shooter, or whatever he is, 92 this year, and I think about 90 point something, almost 91 for his career. You know, those are just very, very frustrating moments in the game. You know, one thing they're going to probably want to work on today on the other end of the floor, though, is attacking his own defense. You know, I thought it was interesting. Van Gundy said on the broadcast last night that Dallas does not do a very good job of getting the ball in the middle of the floor. You know, a lot of times when you play a zone defense, you will see teams flash a big man into the middle of the floor where that big man can operate and, you know, be right in the middle in the heart of that zone and move the ball. And he's right. You know, I think about the times, not that we've seen a lot of zone played against the Mavs this year, but I think about the times when teams do play zone. I don't see Dallas do that very often.
They're passing. Again, what do you do with the zone? Well, you shoot threes to beat it. Well, all they did was pass it around to shoot threes.
Right.
And you're right. They've got to get it inside to then get it outside to shoot the threes. And they didn't attack the zone. And they're playing right in their hands when they do that.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, that's why was, you know, when the Mavs won the title 11 years ago and played probably as much zone defense as any team I've ever seen in a title run. You know, what was the key to that? Well, you know, they just, you know, they were connected very well on a string, and they forced teams out of their rhythm. You know, they made teams indecisive. Teams didn't attack. You know, Dallas did a good job of that, and other teams didn't do a very good job of attacking the zone. So that's going to be something that I think you can bet your bottom dollar when they're getting together out on the West Coast today for practice, working on finding better ways to break down Golden State when they go to zone defense. That will be a big part of what they do today.
Two shooting stats offensively that stuck out to me. 6 shots at the rim, not enough. And corner threes, they were 2 of 11. Mm-hmm. So they only had 11 attempts in the corners of their 48 and hit 2 of them. Mm-hmm. And again, this team is predicated on hitting corner threes. And Golden State will give you corner threes.
Right.
And we weren't able to convert those. But you're right. Luka has shown recovery from bad games.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the team and the coaching staff has shown that they can learn from these situations. And so just to your point about we're going to see more zone, mm-hmm. we're going to see more multiple looks. And I think Luka, in that weird computer brain of his,
mm-hmm.
you can remember dates of random games against Charlotte on the road. He can he knows defenses. He needs to see him once.
Yeah, correct.
And he knows where how to get him in confusion, where the breakdown is.
His trick's better than mine. For sure.
Yes. Slightly. If I were to put you two on a, you know. But I think that he will be able to, and the coaching staff working with him and the other players, be able to break down those looks mm-hmm. going forward. But a couple of things. First of all, I want to mention Draymond on defense. This is just a little random stat I think you'll appreciate.
Okay.
When he was the primary defender, Mavs offensive players were 0 of 9 from 3 against him.
Wow.
Which is the third most misses without a make since 2014.
Wow. So that's impressive, man. Wow.
Draymond Green fun fact.
No, he's I think, you know, you said earlier that you've 180'd on him over the years. He's an incredibly smart basketball player.
Yes.
I mean, he has
You can just tell that when he's on TNT and the way he sees things.
Yes. He is so smart. I mean, sees the game,
which makes it frustrating how emotional he can get in not knowing that sometimes that's not the right thing to do.
Yeah. Not realizing that, yes, you did foul him, right. For example.
There's time and place, and yeah. But that's part of the bit with him, right? Mm-hmm. Steph Curry, you're going to get turnovers.
Yeah.
You're going to play wild ass. So is Luka.
Mm-hmm.
But that also, from that comes brilliance.
Yes.
And from Draymond's emotional play comes the leadership, the communication, all that. So you have to take that. It comes with the dinner,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
But I do think, going back to Luka and playing better and getting having these 48 hours to stew over this game, we know what kind of competitor he is.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he's going to be, you know, drinking a beer on this off day. And by the way, that was in the off day, people. This is not Tony Romo and Cabo. Just relax, everybody. But
wow.
I do think, in a weird way, the scratch on his face is a good thing. Mm-hmm. Because every time he looks in the mirror now,
yeah,
he's going to get pissed.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to be like, all right, I remember who did that to me.
Right.
Yes, it was inadvertent, of course. But
of course, yeah.
I'm going to take it out on that little SOB.
Right.
And I'm not going to let Wiggins, the guy who got the all-star starter spot ahead of me,
mm-hmm.
Have another, you know, get praised for another 48 hours for the great defense he played on me. And, oh, by the way, he got 19 points and carried their team in the first half.
Yeah.
I'm not going to let that happen. I'm gonna let that anger stew in me
mm-hmm.
for these next 48 hours before I get to have Adam again.
Yeah.
I really think that can play into it.
All right. Good. I like that. I like where you're going, with that.
That's what I have, Mark.
Yeah.
It's a 112-87 loss.
No.
We will be back.
You want to do some questions?
We're going to do some questions. Yeah. We're going to do a Saturday audio pod on your favorite audio platform. It won't be on YouTube Saturday.
Gotcha. Yep.
But
yep.
we will have that released probably around noon on Saturday.
Yeah. So maybe even earlier. We'll see.
Maybe even earlier.
Yeah.
We may be hungover if the Dallas wins, so you never know. But Bobby, do we have some questions?
Yes.
From our live Twitch crowd?
Yes, we do. Hello, everybody.
By the way, so, thanks for the support. We have been getting massive numbers on our views and listens, so spread the word.
We do appreciate that.
We'll be here every off day. We're going to be giving you prime content.
Win or lose, we got to post.
Yep. You know? Here we are after a loss. We talked 40 minutes after a loss. We always say after these losses, well, we probably won't go as long today. And then here we are 40 minutes later.
That was a good conversation. Okay, so here's a stat for you first, and then we'll get to questions. So y'all were talking about drives, paint penetration, attacking. In game one, when the Mavs drove to the basket at least one time on a possession, they scored 1.098 points per possession, which isn't amazing, but it's not bad. You're not going to lose because you do that. But when they had zero drives to the basket in a possession, 0.729 points per possession,
which is brutally bad.
And the problem is, there was like 40 possessions where they didn't drive to the basket. So that's a large portion of the game.
Yeah, I mean, that's it right there. We mm-hmm. talked about dribble penetration, mm-hmm. which leads to the threes.
Yep.
And then defense.
2 feet in the paint, man.
2 feet in the paint.
Yep.
And trust me, that will be stressed over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
So Nico Italiano was asking about how should the Mavs attack a box and one? And we didn't see that very often in the regular season. The Mavs were second best in the NBA against zone by points per possession, but oftentimes that's a 2-3. The one game I remember where a team did play box and one was
Toronto.
COVID season, Toronto did, and really, really kind of frustrated the Mavs offense. Mm-hmm. And then I think the very next game, they played against the Pacers, and the Pacers tried that same stuff, and Luka absolutely picked them apart. He had like 7 assists in the first quarter or something.
Well, remember the COVID season, Bobby, before you go any farther with that, remember that was the 1 year that Nate Bjorkren was the Pacers head coach who had been on
Toronto.
Nick Nurse's staff in
that's
Toronto.
Right.
So, that's kind of the
And I think it was the next game they did the same, and Luka just sliced and diced them. And, so,
and that goes back to Luka. Golden State threw it at them. Now, there are going to be adjustments on both ends, but usually the losing team makes more adjustments than the winning team.
Yeah, true.
And so we've seen, I don't think there's any other defensive tricks they can pull out of their bag. There mm-hmm. may be, but that one specifically now has been seen, and I guarantee you, Sean Sweeney, Jason Kidd, and Luka are getting together going, okay,
Igor,
what do we need
to do? Igor as well. Yeah.
How exactly. do you, it's a pretty unorthodox
the Sean Sweeney,
defensive coverage.
Sorry, but Sean Sweeney I mentioned because he's a defensive guy. He knows how to attack his own thing if he were doing it, and so a lot of times those guys are helpful as well.
Yeah.
How would you attack it? Are you pulling Luka way out to let everyone play 4-on-4? Are you trying to get him in the middle of the zone? You're trying to get someone else in the middle of the zone? It's a pretty unorthodox, can't even say that word, unorthodox defense. Yeah.
I'm trying to get somebody in the middle.
Yes.
That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, you can't just shoot over it. As Van Gundy said, you've got to get in the middle to shoot over it.
And
they don't have, and they're playing it without a big. You know, it's not like Clippers last year where we played with Boban in there, and so you have rim protection. It's not a not a rim protection game.
I think the other thing, too, about when you start talking about junk defenses and things like that are one of the best ways to do that is get down the floor before the defense gets set up. Now, it's very hard.
I saw that aid the Mavericks in the Phoenix series. Yeah. They wanted to not only, even after made baskets, go down early before they can get set and get into your offense early.
Yes.
Even in a set offense when it's half court, not waiting until 5 seconds left to make your move.
Now, two things compromised their ability to do that last night. Number one, taking a bit of a page out of what the Mavericks did to Chris Paul with Reggie Bullock, picking up Luka in the backcourt. You did see Andrew Wiggins do that quite a lot last night against Luka. So, number one, that gets them into their offense more slowly. What else gets you into your offense more slowly? Having to take the damn ball out of the basket. And, you know, Golden State shot 56% last night, and that number was even higher in the first half. I think they spent a lot of the first half at 58, 59, sometimes even touching 60%. When the other team is shooting like that, then it's going to be next to impossible to get down the floor and get into your offensive set before they can get set into a junk defensive set.
And on the negative side, you know, is Golden State going to shoot that poorly from three? Now, we can stop them and try to limit again, you know, cut them by a quarter of their attempts, but they shot 34%. Thompson 1 of 4, Curry 3 of 9. So they were, you know, combined 4 of 12 from, you know, 25% from three. Can we bank on that? I don't know. So, but you're right. They've got to get back. They've got to run a little bit more. And listen, they may keep picking Luka up half court, three quarters, wear him down. Luka had 2 points in the second half.
So therefore, one of the counters to this, along those lines, and this is not maybe specifically once a box and one set up, you know, what's the counter to it? But again, I think the counter to a lot of these things is getting into your offense before it sets up. So I'm glad you brought that up. I'm glad we've gotten into this subject because that was one thing I was thinking about this morning. How do you offset them picking Luka up full court? Somebody else brings the ball up the floor.
Right. Which, if you look at the very first play of the game of this season, who brought the ball up the court?
Finney Smith, right?
Finney Smith.
Yeah.
This was thought about from day one, from training camp, of we've got to save Luka's legs for the season, for games, for a series, for when they do things like this in the playoffs, the laboratory for the playoffs.
Yeah.
There are things in the bag that they can do to help alleviate just that issue.
Yep. What do you think about all that, Bobby? I mean, I love your film sessions. I respect your opinion immensely. Do you have any thoughts that you would like to chime in on that?
I mean, I think you guys are right. I think if you're trying to put someone in the middle of the zone, though, that guy has to not only be able to, you know, see cutters on either side, but also turn and face the basket and attack. And I'm just not sure who that guy would be. I mean, maybe Jalen Brunson? Maybe? They used Finney Smith kind of in that role against the Clippers on the short
rolls.
They
want that guy
to
have some size to be able to see over the defense.
Yeah, and then also, yeah, I mean, the willingness to attack, too. And I'm just not sure that, you know, I mean, Dwight can make passes, but I'm not sure how often he's going to be on the floor.
Right.
It'd be interesting to go back to that Indiana game and see how they played that.
Luka was way out at midcourt, and he was, like, slinging 50-footers. He had that one pass to KP. Basically, KP was sort of like, I don't know, hiding in the dunker spot, kind of. And so Luka was way out midcourt, almost like out of bounds, and the defense tilted, and then he was just firing passes right past him. It was pretty nice. But yeah.
And that Indiana game that we're talking about from 2 years ago, Miles Turner didn't play in that game either. So that was another kind of different thing about that game.
Yeah. One thing that they did that I think maybe could have some legs but didn't work last night was that instead of having Luka bring it up, they would just post him up, and then you're kind of forcing them to play man at that point. But Luka wasn't scoring on those.
I think we'll see more post-ups for sure. I think he needs to abuse the smaller players.
Yeah.
Poole, you know, you've got to attack him defensively. You got to wear him down, and Curry, frankly. Mm-hmm.
And to that end, Ralph asks, would you prefer to see more of Luka hunting Poole and Curry just like ISO against those guys, or do you want to run more standard pick and roll to try and kind of keep the flow going?
I mean, I would run more than they did. I don't want to do it. I don't want to get into that's all you want to do. But yes, you've got to do more of that than they did.
More ISO?
Yes, on those two.
Yeah. ISO always kind of worries me a little bit. I mean, if you can get them into it.
More than they did. I don't think that needs to be your steady diet. But
right.
They did almost none of it.
Yep. I think that's a fair. I think that's a fair point.
What did you guys think about Draymond guarding Brunson?
I, as I mentioned, I think that was brilliant, and you know, everybody knows that Brunson's the second best player, frankly, and neutralizing him basically by having Draymond is brilliant.
Yep.
And there's got to be a counter.
Mm-hmm. What do you do about that? You try and get switches on him, or do you? What's the antidote?
Well, this is the whole KP is a decoy thing because you can't run a pick and roll now with Brunson because
then you're bringing
Draymond into the action. So
right.
How do you get – you need to do off-ball action to get Brunson free.
Mm-hmm.
Icarus asks, how many licks does it take to get to the center of a Tootsie Pop?
Not a Tootsie Pop guy.
I'm not really either, but I believe as the commercials will tell you, it takes about four or five. Most people could only like do four or five before they started like crunching the Tootsie
Pop.
Are
you a sweets or a salts person?
They both have their merits, honestly. They
no, do. Both sides. Of me.
if you're going
do you
to
have
give
a sweet
me,
tooth, in other words, if there's cupcakes here, you're like, oh my gosh, I have to have one.
Yeah, if somebody brought in nothing bunt cakes, then yes, I would say, oh man, I love those. You know, those are really good.
You went really specific.
I did. Cupcakes are a great thing. You know, what I like the thing about cupcakes though, and also like, have you ever gone to Sprinkles, the cupcake place? Yes, the icing is the best part of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you icing first?
Yes, no question. Sometimes in the media dining rooms at various places around the league, and I go a lot more on the road than I do at home because I just eat at home and come to the games, but my desserts will be, oh, look at that delicious brownie that has icing on the top, and or look at that delicious piece of cake. I'll just eat the icing and not the cake. I feel like that's sort of a guilty pleasure, but then you're not eating the whole dessert, so you're practicing some level of moderation.
So you're like my mom in the cookie jar who would take a bite out of the cookie and put it back.
Yeah.
And there's tell a, herself yeah, that yeah. she never had a whole cookie, but 12 of the cookies had bites out of them.
You know, I really think there's a lot to be said for you don't want to engage in deprivation. So have a bite of a cookie. If you want some ice cream, go have some ice cream. But instead of like
a bottle of whiskey,
if you want some, go have a shot. But with ice cream, you know, don't get out of, put a big scoop into a bowl.
Don't do the pint.
Yeah. Just get, you know, have three or four spoonfuls out of it, as long as whomever you live with doesn't mind the fact that you're like taking a spoon and eating out of the carton of ice cream.
Oh, this seems to be a topic of conversation in the Follow-Well house.
It's not. You know, I mean, it could be, but it's not. Yeah, it really isn't. I promise, it's not.
Dallas TK mentioned we were talking about people to put in the middle of a zone. Kind of forgot to mention Josh Green. He has the ball movement ability to attack the basket. Didn't get in the game last night until the fourth quarter. Obviously, a really rough series against Phoenix. But do you think he has, you know, could see the floor in this one?
I don't think so.
The reason I don't want to say completely no to that is that, you know, as we've discussed before, the ninth guy in the rotation right now is Ntilikina. In the Utah series and in the first two games of the Phoenix series, it was Josh. Josh really struggled in the first two games of the Phoenix series, and the Mavs went to Ntilikina for his length on defense. And, you know, he's only shot the ball 12 times in the 79 minutes that he's played in games 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 of the Phoenix series. And last night, he's just 3 for 12 on those shot attempts. But they played from in front in a lot of those games, and if we've discussed before with Frank, and if you're playing from in front, then you want him out there
because you can afford the offensive liability.
Yes, because of his defense.
He's really good defensively.
He is. He's very, very good defensively. They weren't playing from in front last night.
You may see some Josh Green spot minutes as a tempo changer, but I don't think you can count on that as some kind of zone-busting solution.
Right. Right. I if they spend a lot of time playing from behind, could J. Kidd go back and change up the rotation? Because I do think, like I was saying, you know, Green is more valuable when you're playing from in front, and he's out there. And as you said, you know, you can deal with the limitations on offense because his defense helps you maintain your lead.
Problem with Green and even Ntilikina to some extent, and that's why, you know, he played 10 minutes, including garbage time, is if you have a non-shooter on the floor, Draymond is just going to sag off that guy and play free safety. And yes, if he does that, that enables them to do whatever they want defensively.
And he's much better doing that than anyone else we've seen. Yes. That the Mavericks have played. Bridges could have been that guy for Phoenix, and I remember there was a point in time in the series when I told you, I was watching, and I think it was, I can't remember which home game it was. I think it was game three, and I was watching, and it's like, what is happening right now? Why are they utilizing Bridges? Like, you know, he's not playing free safety. He's actually, like, guarding Frank at this point. You know, what is he doing? You know, why is he not doing exactly what you said Draymond would be doing? Yeah. So
that's the problem with playing a non-shooter in this series. And so that you know, Powell is the only one you can really get away with because they're playing, you know, with Looney.
Mm-hmm. And they've got to figure out a way. You know, we saw Phoenix do it with Biombo. We saw it happen with Looney last night. For the time that Dwight's on the floor, you know, the guys in the broadcast pointed it out last night that early in the third quarter, they got a lob to Powell, and they said, you know, that's the only time that they've done that. There has to be a way, find a way for the time that he's on the floor to accentuate his strengths more than they've done in a lot of games in these playoffs.
Right. You know? If you're inning eating, don't just be there.
Yes.
And that's has to be an offensive focal point. I'm not blaming this on Powell, but go to those lobs. They're playing drop coverage when that happens, right? So they're trying to take that lob away. Well, then that should leave the floater game for Luka. Mm-hmm. And once he starts hitting those, guess what's going to happen? They'll start playing him more closely and leave the lob game open. Mm-hmm. You know, put them in the same predicament that they're putting us in when they run a Steph Draymond pick and roll.
Right.
So, yes, they need to use the strengths and have that vertical outlet for him. And they just seem to get away from that when Powell's out there.
And to your point about inning eating, Maxey played, I think, 7 minutes in the first half last night, picked up three fouls.
Yeah, foul trouble. Yeah,
and that was that. So
it was very, very detrimental to the Mavericks in his game.
And that's why he's not starting.
Yes, because what happened, you know.
And frankly, that's why Looney's starting. I mean, Looney had a good first half and ended up with 10 points in this game, but they can't afford to play death the whole time because Draymond will get in foul trouble. I mean, this is why these games are played like this.
Yeah, and by the way, you know, Looney is a mobile big guy. He's not a big, you know, he's not a big guy in the sense of Gobert and Ayton. He's not anywhere close. And, you know, whatever negative there is to that, the positive to it is he's about as effective as I can recall seeing of a genuine big when he did get switched on to Luka last night. He's mobile.
Yeah, he's not like the lumbering.
Yes. He's
center.
Not Zubats.
Exactly right.
He's not, you know,
he's not Ayton. Great, but he's definitely better than those kind of guys.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So he's okay in defensive switch situations.
And that's
situations.
Why switching onto him, it seems like the play, but I would, as we talked about, go attack the smaller guys. I mean, too short played halftime. Let's.
Nice.
Last one, Master Fame asks, are we ever going to get to see a clutch time game again?
Eventually, I assume. I mean, at some point.
It's been, what, eight in a row? Nine in a row? There a clutch in the sixth game of the Utah series?
Yeah, that was all, you know, Bogdanovich missed at the buzzer to win the game.
Yeah, sorry.
So that's the
it
last.
It seems like 3 months ago.
It does. No, I'm with you on that. But that's the last time that there's been a clutch game that the Mavericks have played in the playoffs. And I do think it will happen again. You know,
you're going to go out on a limb and say there will be some
be a close
play.
Game. It is weird. It is weird how these games, all with Phoenix and last night so far, have played out this way. But obviously, that's an exception that's happened for whatever reason. You know, I don't know if I have an explanation for it. So I'm operating on the assumption that the law of averages says yes, we will see one at some point.
I just think positioning statement for game two that you know they're going to attack more, they're going to get their looks if they can hit those. And tighten up some of that transition D and some of what they want to do and strategically attack smaller players that, you know, we and hope that the mid-range is because of their defense intensity, aren't going to hit, just like what happened to Phoenix, that you can see, you know, a much different outcome.
Well, the good news is that under Kerr, they're 17-5 in game twos, as opposed to the 20-2 in game ones they were going into last night. So there you go. Yeah, there's always
good. That translates as good news.
Yeah. Always look on the bright side of life.
If he starts singing, that's time for us to go.
There you go. All right. Well, good. Take that with you. And to follow up on your point earlier, we'll be doing audio only, you said, right? After
audio only Saturday, we'll have pregame on the ticket Friday, postgame on Bally.
There you go.
Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time. Tell your friends.